Let's see how the teachers do. When I say harvest, you say time. Harvest time.
Just think what God has in store for you. So we're going to get started, and we're going to open up with a prayer. Minister Karen Sims, she's one of our third year graduates.
Praise the Lord, everybody. I will be reading a scripture from Romans 8, 29 through 31. And it says, for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called, and whom he called, them he also justified. And whom he justified, them he also glorified. What shall we say then? Say to these things. If God be for us, who can be against us? Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Will you all stand with me as we pray? Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. God, we thank you today, Lord. We welcome you in, Lord, to have your way, God. God, we come for no other reason but to lift you up and honor you, Lord. For you are the Alpha and the Omega, God. We come to give you all the glory and all the honor and all the praise, Lord. And Father, we bind everything that's not like you in the name of Jesus. We ask that you have your way, God, in this place today, God. Let the anointing come forth, Lord, in the name of Jesus. And bless us, Lord. God, we just thank you for your mercy and grace today, God. Thank you for each and every one of us that's here for all this time, God. Bless our leaders and our teachers, God. We thank you, Lord, in the name of Jesus, that you will have your way, God, and flesh won't glory in your sight. In Jesus' name, we ask these things and we pray. Let us all say, amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God.
Amen. Somebody just give the Lord some praise. Amen. Hallelujah. Somebody give the Lord some praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's worthy. Somebody give him some glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Adore him with your praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Lord, you are good and your mercy endures forever. Come on, somebody just tell the Lord you've been good to me. Say, Lord, you are good and your mercy endures forever. People, remember Lord, 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 you show me good to. Come on, call his name and say, Lord, 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 show me good to me. You save my soul from sin and shame. Hallelujah. Come on and say, you've been good, you've been good, you've been good, you've been good. So good. You kept me being good. You blessed me. You lifted, you corrected, God. You saved my soul from sin and shame. Hallelujah. Lord, 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 Lord. Hey, show me. Come on and tell the Lord, say, Lord, 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 show me good to me. Hey, God, say, Lord, Lord, Lord. Hey, show me. More than anything. love you more than anything. So much more than anything. Say more than anything. More than anything. I love you more than anything. So much more than anything. Say I love you, G. Come on, somebody just say I worship him. I worship him. Hey, God, and we came into your house just to say, just wanted to tell you that I love you, that I love you more. Come on, somebody just say I love you, Jesus. I love you, G. Hey, God, I worship him. I worship him.
About faith is destroys the fiery darts of the enemy.
Yes, 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 yes.
And I want to say to Pastor Moore, this year I'm going to sponsor a student.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Amen.
That's what I I'm challenging everyone in here, even the some of the students. You want to pull somebody else up because God has taken where taking you where you are now. My goodness, I'm not going to tell my age, but it was some time long, long, long ago when I was a teacher. I was a student. And if you would have told me that I would be up here standing here right now, filled with the Holy Spirit and learning continuously, I said, no, not me. So I want to give back. I want to give back. This is a place that God has put his hand, his personal hand on.
Thank you, Jesus.
I'm telling you. I challenge every student. If you know somebody, tell them about this school. Don't hold on to that nugget and that treasure and put it in your pocket like the story of the talents, you know. It's got to be shared. People got to know. And I thank God that we have a fourth year coming. We have a new first year that's coming. So I'm challenging you to tell somebody else, because I know there's going to be a line wrapped around this building here to get enrolled. I decree it in the name of Jesus. It's going to happen. So don't be surprised. Oh, I thank you. I thank you. I thank you. And I thank you. And I love the Lord. And learn all you can all you can learn. And spread the word about harvest time ministry. Intercessory Bible College. You know, God is just awesome the way he do things, and the people that he put together, the students and the teachers and the dean and, you know, our director and the heads of this house. That's nothing but God. So if you question yourself, should I be here? Look around you. Look what you're seeing. You're in the same class where you saw a person healed. In the name of Jesus. Think about it. You know, this is not Bible study. This is actual school. This is a college. I thank God that this place is accredited. Isn't that something? Accredited. So you can stand up and stand firm that I'm going to a place that God has his hands on. It's accredited. It has teachers that really do love the Lord and filled with the Holy Ghost and anointed by God to teach. So I'm telling you all, meet that challenge.
Say, bless God in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Say, I'm here for a testimony. Say, first I give honor to God. And say, I'm LaWanda McBee. Just in this last couple weeks, the first of the month, my personal testimony, I have so many, but this is the most recent. It's a direct link to me being enrolled in Harvest Time Bible College. And I thank you so much to the teachers, to the staff, to the ministers, to Pastor Moore, for not holding on, as she said, to their anointing, but sharing it. Yes. So I thank God for that.
Yes, yes, yes.
But my husband went to the hospital. He just had high blood pressure. We thought we have a machine at home. We said, oh, it has to be broken, because it was 245 over 146. We kept testing. I said, something's wrong. Well, I sent him straight to the hospital, and testing. A couple days later, he was in surgery for a triple bypass. And I say, thank you, God. Thank you, God, for your goodness, your grace, your mercies. Because his heart was not, the muscles weren't affected because he didn't have a heart attack. It was just a sign telling him to go get checked, and praise God. That's a direct link, I say it again, to Harvest Time Bible College. Yes. Because it kept me strong.
Yes.
I'm still sane. I wasn't running around like, oh, what do I do? Because I was taught to pray the word and pray the answer.
Yes.
You know, don't worry about the problem.
Yes.
Because by His stripes, we are healed. Yes. And I say thank you so much to all of you who are just drumming that in us.
Yes.
And I can just go down the row and have a now faith from my teacher. The demons know your name, so make sure you know the word. And also, the just spoken word. Memorize that word and know it. And you also get a pull from your belly. And I thank you so much. And even when I came off the elevators when he was in surgery, a young lady said, I had on a t-shirt with the scripture. She said, can you pray for my son? And I didn't even frantic and say, I have my own problems, lady. I said, yes, I can.
Yeah.
And so that came out of me.
Yeah.
And I knew the words to pull from. Thank you, Harvest Time Bible College. So I say it's working. I encourage you to enroll. And my husband is doing great. And I say that's a direct link of what God can do. When you yield to Him. And you learn that here.
Yes,
thank
yes,
you, Jesus. Yes, so I encourage you to enroll, enroll, enroll. Yes,
hast thou not known, hast thou not heard, that God, creator of the ends of the earth, faint not? Neither is he weary, for there is no searching of his understanding. He gives power to the faint, to them that have no might, he increases their strength. Even the young man shall utterly fall, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles, they shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. My name is Al Jackson. This is my beautiful wife, Yasmin. And our testimony is just this. I guess I'm going to do all the talking and not let the lady do the talking this time. But our testimony is this. We both decided 2 years ago to come to Harvest Time. It was a struggle, but we enjoyed it. We learned a lot the first year. The first year taught us a lot of discipline, taught us how to respect one another, how to respect other people. It taught us the Word of God. I thank God for what He has shown us and what He has done for us at this school. Our second year, when we started last year on the very first day, the chancellor, that's what I'm gonna call Pastor Deborah, the chancellor of the school, she said this to us, and I believe it came out of 1 Corinthians 2 and 9. Eyes have not seen, ears have not heard. I can't remember the rest of it, but what it calls is this, the deep things that God can take us through spiritually. It's what she said was this, that the deep calls unto the deep.
Yes.
And when she said that, that touched my soul, that touched my spirit. And I wanted to get a little bit more, so I started digging a little bit more. A lot of times when you dig for gold, you can dig for gold, but if you don't put your heart in it, you're not going to find anything. So my heart was in it to dig for the Word of God. My heart was in it to search for what I can find that God has for me. I thank the Lord that He has taken me, He has taken my wife, He has taken all these students that you see over here. He's taken us from different things, different parts of the world. And look at us now. All of us have a direct direction. We're going somewhere. Some of us are going to be ministers, some teachers, some prophets. But God has really invested in us. And I thank you, Harvest Time. I thank all the teachers.
Yes.
I see Ms. Taylor here tonight, who last year taught us a great deal, a lot. I really respect you. I respect all of you. Excuse me. I respect, and I'm going to call it my little white James Brown. Kevin Strange. we would come in and we would have chapel every Tuesday.
Yeah.
And this brother would get down. Sometimes if he didn't do the James Brown, he was like Marvin Gaye. He just really, he would always put the word into us.
Yes.
And that is truly a remarkable thing.
Yes.
So for those of you who are thinking about going to school, come here. It has a lot to offer. And I always say this, I wish more men would come out and take your role. We as men, we have fell back and not done the things that I believe God has called us to do. But I thank the Lord today that my brother-in-law, who's sitting in here in the back there, he's going to be the next man to enter this school. I thank the Lord for him. He and I both have went down a hard road together. We look at where we are today.
Yes.
We are here at Northside, and Harvest Time is the greatest school, but Northside Christian Center is the best church that I know of. And my pastor, Pastor James Hill and Marilyn Hill, are the two best pastor and co-pastor anybody could ever have. So I just want you to know that we love you, the Lord loves you, and Harvest Time tomorrow at probably about 1:45, we'll be out of here, we'll be graduating. We'll be able to throw the tassel to the other side. Throw our hats up in the air. And say glory, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
No, I don't think so. Only when the Holy Ghost moves. Otherwise, not a good look. But praise God. We've come to this part of our time together for a part of worship, which is also our offering and giving. You know, during this past year, as I've mentioned to the staff, the excitement to see what we have this night with the students, to be in each of your years and to be a part of your lives has not only been a blessing, but it's also a time of sowing into your lives, which is a form of offering, as we are about to give here in a second. But when we sow, we also reap. So I know that there are 20-some people here tonight who have been sown into by various ministers in this school, and you're about to give birth and give fruit. And what is so exciting is that we may have a third of this side filled, but there's going to come a day when we have both sides filled to the brim with students, because we sow and we reap. And I'm excited tonight, as we're about to take our offering, that we are going to be giving into this ministry what has been given unto you. And what's exciting is that because of your giving, there is going to be an explosion of return. Because the Bible says, Jesus himself said, "Give, and it shall be given. Good measure, pressed down and shaken together, shall men give unto your bosom." Why? Because God said that if you would give, you shall receive. This is a spiritual law that we obey. And tonight, I just want to ask you to stand with me as we begin to get ready for our offering. And I want to pray for each and every one of us as we're about to give. Father, I thank you so much this evening that we give unto you. We give the first fruits of what we have received. We thank you for this student body. We thank you for this school. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for the mandate that is upon this school. And we give unto you, Lord Jesus, tonight as an offering to sow into this ministry, to sow into the future generation of the Church of Jesus Christ here on the earth. We thank you, Lord, that this ministry is not local, but it is international, and it will be worldwide. Why? Because you have a mandate to teach your people how to pray. And Father, we thank you as we give this evening. We do not give strictly to this ministry. We give unto you, and we sow into the Lord Jesus Christ for your kingdom and for your glory. And I thank you, Lord, for everyone tonight to be blessed. Because what they have received, they shall also give. And I thank you for it in the powerful name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Praise God. Please bring your offerings.
Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Hallelujah. Somebody just say, Lord. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. People from every nation sing. People from every nation and tongue. From generation to generation, we worship you. Come on and say hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship you for who you are. Hallelujah. Say, Lord, you are good. Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever. Hallelujah. People from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. Come on and cry and say hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship you for who you are. Hallelujah. One more time, say we worship you, we worship, and we give you all the glory, and we say hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship you for who you are. Hallelujah. Somebody say you are good, and you are good all the time. Hey, all the time. You are good. You are, say you are good. You are good all the time, Lord. Hey, and all the time you've been good. You've been good to me. Say you are good all the time, and all the time you are good. Somebody say people from every nation, people from every nation, from generation to generation, we were. Hey, come on, somebody give them a high praise and say hallelujah. For who you are. Hallelujah. Come on and give the Lord some praise. Amen. Hallelujah. Because
we have a preaching machine in our midst. And I think he needs a worldwide microphone. Let everybody ought to know who Bishop Gregory Davis is. Amen. He is an awesome man of God. I consider him a friend in the ministry, he and his wife. Little did I know when I was a little 7B, that's what they used to call us, at Hamilton Junior High. And his wife was a student at Hamilton Junior High, as well as Kevin. Little did I know we would make full circle. And as we grew up, we all became ministers of the gospel. All right, all right. And I'm so thankful for that. And his wife is, I consider, a friend as well. And one thing that stands out to me about Bishop, not only is he an excellent preacher, but there was a time in my life I was really going through. And I called Bishop. I like to be led who I call. I miss it sometimes, but I didn't miss it this time. But when I called Bishop, he and his wife both came, and they sat down and counseled and prayed with me. And when you know when you're hurting and somebody's speaking to your life, that means a lot. You know, I didn't leave feeling condemned. I didn't leave feeling guilty. When that meeting was over, I had some direction. I was uplifted. Amen. And I was encouraged. And I think a few days later, God just severed the whole thing. And so I was thankful that I had called. And in his counseling, he gave a word that came to pass, you know, that it was for me to move on And in case I wanted to stand still, God just broke it up.
Yes.
And he moved me on. And so today I'm grateful. Amen. If I could sing I'm grateful, I would sing it. So don't you want me? No, I'm just kidding. Woo, glory to God. But he's the bishop of New Life Christian Center. Amen. And he's a powerful man of God. He's a man full of the word, a man of integrity, and a man after God's own heart. May we stand. And this time I want you to clap. I know we don't clap for Jesus. Some of y'all still clapping for Jesus. I done told y'all about that. But anyway, we can clap for this man to God. He's Sister Chanel, Minister Chanel's pastor. Minister Rita's blood brother. My daughter, she used to like to say that. We blood sisters. Her blood brother. And my spiritual brother. Let's say amen for Bishop Gregory Davis.
Amen. Amen. All those accolades, I don't know if I measure up to them, but God is good, and he is good all the time. We're here to praise him. We came here with one objective tonight, is to worship him and to give him the glory.
Yes.
All that he's done in all of our lives. All of us have received something wonderful when we receive Jesus Christ as our personal Lord and Savior. We ought to glory in that and thank God for that every opportunity we get. Continue to build a sound relationship with him. Because it's the relationship with Christ that will take you through trials and tribulations.
Yeah.
Every other kind of thing you have that goes on in your life. So you want to stay close to God so you can listen to his spirit so that he can speak to you, because his sheep do hear his voice.
Yeah.
How many of y'all are part of the fold?
Yeah.
And I want to thank Pastor Deborah and Harvest Time College for allowing me to come tonight to share with you all the instructors and all the people who are involved with it. It's an honor for me to be here tonight. I came here to encourage you all, to tell you some things about what I've experienced in my life. Since you're going into ministry, you need to know what ministry is all about. You need to understand the many vicissitudes that you're going to experience in this life, the many things that's going to happen to your life. And you're going to need one ingredient to take you through. And I'm going to talk about that tonight. So I want us to just look at some scripture tonight, and I'll be sharing with you what God has placed on my heart. Amen?
Amen.
Give the Lord a hand praise.
Amen.
Amen. God is good, and I'm thankful to be here, and I'm just going to give you what God gave me, and I know that it's going to bless your life, because it's all about being blessed. Let us stand for the reading of God's word. Amen. Let's look at 1 Corinthians 5, 15 and 10. Apostle Paul is writing to the church of Corinth, and he makes a statement that is a profound statement that we need to talk about tonight. He says, "But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace which was bestowed upon me was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God that is within me." I want everyone to say, "I am what I am.
I am what I am.
By the grace of God."
By the grace of God.
Say it one more time. I am what I am.
I am what I am.
By the grace of God.
By the grace of God.
Amen. You may be seated.
Yeah.
Father, I thank you tonight. I glorify you for the opportunity to stand before your people, to minister to you, them, the uncompromising word of God, and to encourage their hearts as they launch into the ministry amongst many different things that they're going to experience. I want you to continue to bless them and watch over them and keep them, and bless the leadership, the chancellor of this school, bless the students. And we pray, God, that you would just bring more students into this ministry, because this ministry is efficient, sufficient, And we thank you right now for them and what they're doing and how they're reaching out and changing people's lives. We glorify you for it. In the mighty name of our Savior Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
In the book of Titus, Apostle Paul writing to Titus in Crete, he says, For the grace of God that brings salvation hath appeared to all men. So that means that the grace of God is available to all men. But you must have a clear understanding of what the grace of God is. And he goes on to explain what he means. He said, teaching us. See, the grace of God is something that teaches us. And it characterorily teaches us certain things that God wants us to know about his grace. His grace is not cheap. It's not something that you use to escape from sin. It's not something that gives you permission to sin so that you can repent for your sin. The grace of God is not a vehicle that we can use in order to escape the things of God because we want to get away with things or do things that we're not supposed to do and then plead his grace. God's grace has never been for that. The grace of God is more than that, and we have minimized what God's grace really is. And I want to tell you tonight that because you have accepted the call of ministry, you have to understand when you accept the call of ministry, everything you do and everything you accomplish is only going to be by the grace of God. If you get mixed up in ministry and you begin to think that you're doing it, you begin to think that the only reason it's happening is because you're praying, the only reason it's happening because you're fasting, the only reason it's happening because all these other different things, then you are mixed up about how the kingdom of God operates. God does not operate like that because God is going to always get the glory for everything that happens. Whatever happens in your life, God's going to take you through situations. God's going to allow you to go through trials and tribulations. Sometimes you're going to fail. Sometimes you're going to win. But he's going to show you that every time you win and every time you fail, it's a part of his plan and you're not out of your will just because stuff is not happening to your agenda. You see, God is in control. I've learned this in my life through ministry. I was a young man, and I was very insecure, and I was looking for something in my life, and I tried to find it in people. You know, I tried to get my self-esteem from people and friends and different things like that, and that didn't work for me. I never was satisfied with what they gave me. And it caused a void in my heart, and it caused a longing in my heart. And when it caused that longing and void in my heart, I began to seek after God. And when I began to seek after God, I met him. I met him at a young teenage age. In 1978, I started preaching. I started my ministry in Denver, Colorado, at the Pillar Truth Church, my uncle's church. My pastor told me I was too young to preach and that I didn't know enough, so he wouldn't let me minister. So I went to my uncle's church, and he told me he's the Church of God in Christ. He said, if God called you, he qualified you. And if God called you, you could preach. Well, I got up there to preach, and I messed up. I didn't know what I was doing. I didn't know what I was saying. I was started out with one scripture. I don't know where I ended up. You know, but I had a heart to do. I had a heart to serve God. Amen. And then when I got back, my uncle came back and went to our church and told the pastor that I had been called and he shouldn't try to stop me from preaching. So he allowed me to preach, and I got a license in February 29, 1979. And ever since that day, I have been preaching and teaching and doing things in the kingdom of God. And I have sometimes when I first started preaching, I thought that, you know, I was happy about what I was doing. I was glad to be there. And every time I would go to church, I'd always want to go up to the front so I could be seen.
Come on, Bishop, make it
fine. You know, and anytime the ministers would come together, I would go up there and I'd sit amongst them because I wanted to be seen and to be seen as being a minister. Because it got to the point where it wasn't about me. It got to the point to where it was about me being seen. Amen. And then God began to purge that out of me. He began to take me through things. He began to show me things. He began to develop me. He filled me with the Holy Ghost right in the prayer meeting. Amen. In a Baptist church, I started speaking in tongues. God filled me with the Holy Ghost. All everybody was praying. They were looking at me like I was crazy. But I was praying in the Holy Ghost. A young brother came to the church. He said, I'm from the Church of God in Christ, and I know what they're teaching you is good. He said, but there's more to this. And I told him, I said, I want all that God has. You know, if God has something for me, I want it. He showed me in the scripture. He said, this is what God will give you. He will fill you with the Holy Ghost. And he prayed for me. And after he prayed for me, he said, you just pray. And I prayed and God filled me with the Holy Ghost. Amen. When God filled me with the Holy Ghost, it wasn't these imitation tongues. It was the tongues that come from heaven. Amen. When God fills you with the Holy Ghost, you can't stop speaking in tongues. When God fills you with the Holy Ghost, you don't have control of it. Amen. So I'm just telling you, God developed me, and I began to understand as I lived and as my ministry developed that the things that I needed to know was by his grace. You see, it's by the grace of God. It's not by our abilities. Amen. 1 Corinthians says, if you received it, if you received it from God, Apostle Paul writes, why do you glory in it? As if you've done something to have it. So I'm telling you tonight that in ministry, I know you all, some of y'all in the fivefold ministry, some of you in administrations, some of you in different types of ministry, but you have to understand that whatever you are is because you received it. And if you received it, I mean, it wasn't yours. It was something that God gave you by his grace. Amen. I'm going to tell you something. If you start with grace, you're going to end with grace. The Bible says, not of works, lest any man should boast. There's a reason God tells us not to begin to work in his presence and start taking credit for things. The priests, when they went into the holies of holies, they couldn't even sweat. God gave them garments that would absorb the sweat. They couldn't go into the presence of God with sweat. Because God doesn't want anybody working in his presence trying to take credit for what he does. So the grace of God is more than just a quick fix or something that we use to get out of trouble when we don't want to do what God tells us to do. The grace of God is something that God gave us to empower us to have the ability to do things in ministry. And it's only by his grace. Why is it by his grace? Because you don't deserve it. Amen. A lot of times the church, it leaves the dispensation of grace and goes back into the dispensation of works. And the dispensation of works didn't work for them. Amen. The dispensation of works didn't work for them. God did not give them the priesthood so that they would live it. God gave them the priesthood to show them their sin. It was their skill master to just tell them to let them know that they couldn't live it. Yes. And they couldn't qualify for the blessing of God. Yes. But oftentimes we get to the point where we think we can do something. I'm not saying you can live like the devil. I'm telling you that it's all by the grace of God. And when you realize that, the struggle is over. I'm going to say it one more time. When you realize it's by the grace of God, the struggle is over. You can go and live your life for God. You can go and feel free. You have liberty. You understand that it's all because of the finished work of Jesus Christ. When Jesus died on that cross and he rose on the third day, what God said, God is given the confirmation. He's validating that what Jesus done was enough, and he gave his approval, and he raised him from the dead and brought to us a salvation that was bestowed upon us that had nothing to do with us. It had everything to do with Christ, and every gift that you have and everything that you do in life and ministry is because of the finished work of Christ. Therefore, you and I cannot take any credit. We cannot take any credit. You need to know this when you're going in ministry. I know a lot of us, we don't want to hear this. But this is what God's word teaches. Yes. Amen. Right. Titus says this, the grace of God, what does it do? Teaching us to deny ungodliness. Titus says God's grace teaches us, what does it teach us? Now wait a minute, we got to qualify what kind of grace he's talking about. He said the grace that bringeth salvation. What kind of grace did you get saved by? You got saved by the grace that bringeth salvation. He's saying that same grace that you got saved by that brings salvation is given to you to teach you to deny ungodliness. Not to sin, and then plead the blood of Jesus. You know, it's one thing to sin and one thing to ask for forgiveness, but it's a whole different story when you repent of your sin. You see, I'm telling you, you're a minister. You're going into the ministry. You ought to be an example. You ought to be an epistle for men to read daily. You ought to be the man. You want to be the person that people look up to you. And you want to be a minister who people look up to you because you live your life beyond reproach.
That's right.
Okay? We have enough people in the ministry who are playing church, doing things they don't have any business doing. We need some people in the church that's going to do the right thing all the time. Denying unto, listen to what else he says. Worldly and worldly lust. The grace of God teaches you to deny worldly lust. It doesn't teach you to lust and then do something you don't have any business doing and then repent and ask God to forgive you and then do it again. Amen. Then repent and ask God. It doesn't teach you. The real true grace of God teaches you to deny ungodliness and worldly lust. Somebody say, I know he's talking to you tonight. I know he's telling you something. Like, you need to know this as a minister, because if you don't get that, if you don't too fine tune that in, you're going to have problems. Because if you don't understand it's the grace of God, you're not going to be able to withstand the onslaught of the enemy. Amen. I heard one person get up and said, "We got faith that the fiery darts, but the faith that we have is the faith that we receive from God by grace."
Yes. Yes.
Everything. So look at your name. Say,
it's all grace.
And I'm not a part of the grace church. I'm not coming to you because my church is named Grace. I'm telling the truth about what God's word, what I've learned in my life and what I've experienced with God. I'm telling you what grace teaches you. Amen. And the Apostle Paul says, I am what I am. If you want to look at my life, you want to evaluate everything I've done in ministry, you want to look at all that I have accomplished, I want you to know that the reason that I am what I am is because of the grace of God. It has nothing to do with me. It has to do with the grace that was bestowed upon me when God first saved me. Look at your neighbors. I am what I am by the grace of God. Oh, Lord, have mercy. We're going to get into this. Amen. I feel something. And now he goes on to say that grace teaches us to live soberly. What does soberly mean? When you're sober, you're alert. That means be on alert. Grace teaches you that you got things that you're going to be dealing with, and you have to have the right attitude when you're facing things so you can make the right decision. Because one decision can sidetrack you and take you to places that you don't want to go. And then he went on to say, to live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Look at your neighbor and say,
it's not our grace.
It's God's grace.
Amen.
Apostle Paul writes this in 2 Corinthians, where he said, for this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. I sought the Lord. I asked the Lord about this. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee. Why is this grace sufficient? He said, I know you want me to take it away, but I can't take it away because it hadn't worked its way out in you yet. I understand what you're saying. I know you don't want to deal with it. A lot of people want to talk about the thorn in the flesh and what it was, and theologians want to argue, but that's not the point of the scripture. The point of the scripture is never about his thorn in the flesh. The point of this scripture is about God saying, my grace is sufficient.
Yes.
Okay? God begins to tell him, my grace is sufficient for you. Amen. And I'm not going to change my mind
on what I'm doing in your life right now because you're feeling uncomfortable. I'm not going to change the plan. I'm not going to abort the plan that I have for you because you're feeling uncomfortable, Paul. I'm just going to tell you and give you some encouragement to let you know that my grace is sufficient. And a lot of people give the definition of grace as unmerited favor. That does nothing for me. Does it do anything for you? Let me tell you what grace is. And you take this through your ministry. You take this definition through your ministry and use it every time you're going through trials and tribulation, because this is what will bring you different. Grace is God's willingness to use his power to meet your need. That means every time you're going through something, the Bible says God should supply all of our need. It never said, a lot of people go and say, God says, the Bible says, God's, you read the scripture, my God should supply all of my needs. It doesn't say needs. It says need. What is a need? Something you need right now. It's a present situation you're in. He'll supply. When you say need, you're talking about stuff all in the future. Because you're going to have needs in the future. God should supply your present need right now. But when you get the scripture mixed up and you don't interpret it right, you get a fantasy to what God's going to do that they never said what he was going to do. So grace, say with me, grace is God's willingness to use his power and authority to meet my need. See, that works in every situation. That works when you have, that works when you don't have. Everything you have today is because of God's grace. Everything you are today is because of God's grace. And that's why God told Paul, he said, listen now, I want you to understand something, Paul. You only strengthen because of me. And I can't reveal my power unless you're going through something. I can't reveal who I am unless you are experiencing some difficulty. And the Bible says in 1 Peter, that think it not strange concerning the fiery darts of your faith, the trials of your faith. If something strange is happening. You see, we in the church believe that when stuff happens to us, we're supposed to be exempt from trouble. But we're not, because God gives us the grace to go through. It's not because you all that in the back of the ship, not because you all that strong, not because you fasting and praying and coming to church and jumping up and down and turning cartwheels in the church. That has nothing to do with the amount of grace that God has bestowed upon you. Grace is not a bad word. Grace is the most important ingredient we have as believers. The Bible says you have been saved by grace through faith. And not of works. If you have been saved by grace, then it's going to take grace to keep you. If you got saved by grace today, only grace is going to keep you. And you ought to give God a praise right now for pouring out his grace in your life. I thank God for the grace of God. He says this. He said, for my grace is sufficient to me. My strength is made perfect in weakness. Yes. Paul said, I learned something from what God told me when he said it's by his grace. Then he said this, he makes this station. Most gladly, therefore, I'd rather glory in my weakness. He said, I'd rather praise God for being weak. The Bible says, let the weak say that I'm strong. I know it says that. But it doesn't tell you, let the weak say you're strong. Let the weak say I'm strong in the Lord. Not strong in your search. He said, I'd rather glory in my weakness, because I've learned that if I glory in my weakness, what happens? The power of Christ rests upon me. How many want more? How many more? How many of y'all today? Can I get anybody in the house who wants more power? How many of y'all want more power? Paul says his power rests on me when I recognize that I need him, because I am weak in certain areas of my life. And I say, God, I need you. Paul was puzzled by this. Because he thought God should deliver him because he's out delivering other people. But he didn't have that kind of reciprocal agreement with God, because God told him when he first commissioned him, when he told him, Ananias opened his eyes, you know what God told him his ministry is going to do? He's going to show you how many things you must suffer through me, for me. Wow. And when they pulled the Apostle Paul out of Lystra as a dead man, put him outside the city, what do you think the Apostle Paul said when he first got up? He said, I have learned that through much tribulation shall we enter the kingdom of God. See, he thought it was a picnic. He thought everything was going to be la-la. He wanted to go in the power. Ministry is not fun. It's not glamorous. You're not getting into a vocation where it's glamorous. You're not getting into a vocation where everybody pats you on the back. You see, people don't know what ministers go through. The reason you don't know is because they got a call on their life, and God is pushing them and pushing in the people with and pushing them with people who won't listen. Kind of things to regular people in congregation, but you people in the Bible college, and I can talk and get a little deep with y'all and be real about, you know, I didn't come to play games. I didn't come in here tonight to tell you all of this and how great you are, and you've been praying and you got all these accolades. I didn't tell you that. I came to tell you that no matter how many degrees you can have more degrees than a thermometer. You still don't need grace. Somebody say, I know he's preaching to you now. You've been thinking you all that a bag of chips, but you're not. Come on, why don't you give the Lord a hand praise? Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Amen. Now, you see, God will bring you to a point to where you feel just like Paul. And it takes time to get there, I'm telling you. You don't get there overnight. What point do you want to get to? This is the point Paul got. Listen to what he says. What a tremendous word. He says, because of all these things, therefore I take pleasure. He said, I take pleasure in my infirmity. I thank God I'm weak, because he learned some things about acknowledging that it's not about him, it's about God. And when God gets ready to change something, it ain't a devil in hell or on earth or in the heavens that can stop God from doing what he says he's going to do when it's his time to do it. You don't have to worry about if God's going to do what he said he would do. You can trust in his word. He watches over his word to perform it. Greater is he that is in you. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, but it's going to be by grace. If it started with grace, it's going to end with grace. You don't have to worry about it. Therefore, when you don't feel like doing it and you're not instant in season, out of season, give him praise anyhow, because it's his grace. Hallelujah. So this is the kind of things I'm talking about. These are the kind of things that give you sustaining power. You need some sustaining power, because you're going to go through stuff that's going to rock your world. You're going to go through stuff as a minister that's going to rock your world. You're not going to know if heaven's up or if heaven's down. That enemy knows how to put pressure on you, and God allows him to put pressure on you. But if you stand still in the salvation of the Lord, you'll be just like Job. And at the end of the day, you'll get double for your trouble. Come on, say it now. You'll get... The Bible says in the last chapter of Job that God gave him two times more than he had before the trial and tribulation. If you will stand still to see the salvation of God, I guarantee you it's going to be better than you thought it was going to be, and God's going to give you double for your trouble. But you've got to know that it's by his grace. Paul's supposed to say, I take pleasure in my infirmity. He said, in reproaches. Listen to this one. This one kills us right here. In necessities. I take pleasure when I need something. I don't get mad at God, still cursing God, still questioning God. I take pleasure in my necessity. I take pleasure in my reproaches. I take pleasure in persecution. I take pleasure in distress for Christ's sake, because I've learned that when I am weak, he shows up and shows out. How many of y'all want God to show out in your life? You got to learn to praise him. And all the Bible says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praises shall continually be in my mouth. I will get up in the morning and praise him. I praise him in the morning. I praise him in the noontime. I praise him in the evening. I praise him when I'm going in and I'm coming out. I praise him when I wake up. I praise him when I'm asleep. I praise him all day long, because he's worthy to be praised. Whether or not I feel blessed or not, he's still worthy to be praised. I came to tell you, my God is worthy to be praised. Get to your feet and give God some praise tonight, Cole. Come on, give him some praise. Grace, Lord. Paul says, there's no longer I, but Christ that lives in me. The life that I now live, I live by the Son of God. He said, I've learned that it's not me, but it's Christ that lives in me. And then he says in that next verse, the reason I learned that, and I now don't frustrate the grace of God. How do I not frustrate the grace of God? I understand that the power that I need inside of me is Yeshua, the Savior, the one who saved me, who's keeping me, who's watching over me, who paid the price for me, and he's going to come through for me. Therefore, I don't go leave the premise of work, of the grace, and go back to works. Oh, sit down. I'm not through. Sit down. Y'all sit down. Y'all stood up. I'm not finished. I got some good stuff here. Amen. God's grace is good. I'm trying to enlighten you tonight to understand that you're in ministry. Pastor Deborah can attest to everything I'm telling you, because she's a pastor dealing with y'all. She's a pastor. Amen. You know, and she's taking it up on herself, and we've been chastened. You know, we make these great big words, but when we really want to tell you what you should be, I'm gonna tell you what you should be tonight. When God calls you to preach, instead of being happy, you need to be horrified. You see, I remember my father-in-law told me that I didn't understand this. I was a young minister, and he was an assistant pastor at First Baptist North for about 30 years. And he told me that Pastor Jordan used to be a pastor there years ago. He said he had a bunch of Bible students, a lot of people talking, they'd been called to preach. And they were all talking about how they wanted to talk to preach. He said, well, he said, I'm gonna tell y'all something. If y'all can do anything else in the body of Christ, do that. Amen. He'd been there for 30 years. He understood all the different trouble that ministers. I'm trying to paint you a picture to where you leave here with a dependency on the grace of God. I want you to be dependent on the grace of God, because I know if you depend on the grace of God, you're going to make it. Amen. You're going to make it. And when you are, as a minister, I don't care if you're a pastor, evangelist, don't depend on people. Depend on God. Because people will make you a whole lot of promises. I remember my wife and I, you know, I'm real. My wife is real. I'm real. I tell real stories. I'm a transparent preacher. I don't cover up anything about my life. I'm not perfect. Ain't never been perfect. I believe the blood of Jesus cleanses me of all my sins. I'm not a perfect person. Amen. I tell people all the time, if you're looking for a perfect trick, new life's not the perfect trick. And when you come, it's going to be imperfect. Amen. It's made up of imperfect people. That's why we need God's grace. Yes. Amen. So, you know, my wife and I, you know, we started ministries and started doing the things, and all the time we've always going through stuff with people and different things like that. And I had a brother in my church when I first started. He had a lot of money and he was buying stuff and all kind of equipment and stuff like that. And he came in my office one day and he said, you know, we have enough money, Pastor, you can go full time. I said, okay. And I got excited. I went home, told my wife. She said, I said, Monty, I can go full time. She said, no, you can't. I said, what you mean? He said, this is just what she told. He said, them same people that was saying, Hosanna, Hosanna, on a Monday, was saying, crucify him on a Thursday. She said, what you going to do is you're going to keep going to work. And I listened to her. And what happened 2 months later, that guy left the church. You can't depend on people. You have to depend on the things of God, and you have to depend on God. Let's not bore you. I'm going to get ready to finish here in a minute. But the grace of God. Have you been saved? The grace that was bestowed upon you is what has kept you. Minister Kevin can attest to this. He's a minister. He has his own worldwide ministry right now. He can attest that you got to trust God. You got to trust God for every payment, every purchase, everything. I tell all the people all the time, when I first started New Life Christian Center in Tulsa, it used to be in Cushing, we moved to Tulsa, I had 8 people. And I told God I needed a building. And old Antioch Church, somebody told me they had it available, and I said, I'll go down and look at it. I walked in there, it's a large building, and I'm thinking, man, we can do this, I really like to have this. Well, I went home and told my wife about it. She said, you don't need to do that. I said, why not? She said, well, you know you ain't got enough people. Well, when she said that, I knew that was her and wasn't God. Now, I'll listen to you when you're talking, you know, out of the spirit, but when you start talking about that. Out of the flesh, well, no, that ain't God, that's just you. So I said, I'm gonna trust God. So I talked to him and everything, and I set up an appointment to sit down. I took 2 of my members, Reed was on the board doing me. We went over there, I had dressed all up with my suit on, had my briefcase and everything, walked in there like I had some money. I did, I walked in there like I had some money. We had $8.95 in our checking account. And I asked him, how much do we have to pay down on it? He said, y'all got to have $25,000 in 30 days. I said, we'll have it. Amen. I went back to my wife. I told her what I told her. She said, I don't know how you're going to do it. I said, God going to do it. Because when I went in there, I felt like impressed to the Lord that this was our place. I said, we'll have it. A long story short, $25,000. We wrote them a $25,000 check on the last day before it expired. And do you think for 1 minute that while I was waiting on that to happen, the devil wasn't talking to me about what God not gonna do? You're gonna look like a fool. It ain't gonna ever happen. You need to quit. You need to call him and tell him you ain't gonna have the money. On the 29th day, he really got on my case. You need to call him and tell him you ain't gonna have the money. Look what you have. You don't have enough money. Go on and call him. I said, I'm not gonna call him. I'm gonna wait on God because God told me. And I'm telling you right now, I don't take credit for that. Because I waited and because I had faith, it was the grace of God that was bestowed upon me to withstand the onslaught of the enemy. And when you depend on God's willingness to use his power to meet your need, you'll never go wrong. God will always show up. God will always show out. And I felt so proud when I walked in that pastor's office and gave him $25,000. Check. And I'm still there. Come on, give God a praise. Give him a praise. And that's why I thank God and I give God praise, because he's not a respected person. If he'll do it for me, he'll do it for you. Just keep your hand in God's hand and don't compromise your life for anybody. And don't try to use the excuse, well, God's grace will forgive me. That don't work according to scripture. That's somebody else's idea. God says, my grace teaches you to deny ungodliness and evil stuff. It's not, that's not me. That's not my spirit. That's somebody else's spirit telling you that. Amen. And I'm not a sinner saved by grace. I used to be. Well, you say that, Bishop, because the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 5, 2 Corinthians 5 and 21, he says, for he who knew no sin became sin on my behalf, that I might be made the righteousness of God in him. Right now, I am the righteousness of God. I'm in right standing with God because of Jesus Christ. The grace brings me into the presence of God. The Bible says you have access to grace. You have access to God because of the throne of grace. Grace brings you into the presence of God. When you get ready to pray and you get ready to seek God, grace brings you into the presence of God. Not whether or not you're doing right. The only thing brings you into the presence of God is his grace. The grace that has been bestowed upon you. And when you need to go home and get your Bible and read about how much grace. Everybody want to talk about Noah. The Bible says he found grace in the sight of God. He said he was a righteous man, but he didn't go and say, well, because of his righteousness, I saved him. He said, no, because of God's grace, Noah and his family were saved. It's always, when you read the scripture, you will find that everything in there, all the accomplishments of men, has only been by God's grace. People say, grace wasn't in the Old Testament. Yes, it was. It's in the Old Testament. It's always been God's grace. Somebody give God a hand of praise for his grace. Amen. I'm excited about being here. I hope that the things that I've said to you have encouraged you in ministry, because you need encouragement. Amen. If you see somebody going through trouble, encourage them. Tell them about God's grace. Tell them about God's ability and God's power. If you do that, you'll be considered a good soldier in the kingdom of God, Pastor.
Hallelujah. Told you he's a preaching machine. I just have a testimony to give. This school has given me a lot of strength. Like, when I first entered this school, it's just hearing the word of God, it was a matter of fact. Rita told me about it. I had just lost my mom. And I'm be honest, like I lost my dad like 5 years before then. And my mama was all I had. You know, we don't really have a whole lot of family here in Oklahoma. And then, you know, Bishop Davis took me in and Rita took me in, they my family. And Rita introduced me to Pastor Moore. And it has given me a whole bunch of hope. Like, I'm just so much stronger. So much stronger. Like, I am actually the strength of my family, of my siblings that's left. And they really depend on me. And my strength, and of course, we talk, it's God's grace. But I can just feel God's presence. And Pastor Moore, you just feed things into me, your strength that you have in God, and it's kind of just flow into me. And Bishop Davis, you too. I love you. Love you too, Rita. And Pastor Mo. I love y'all. So I'm just so thankful. And my sister's back there, third year, standing strong.
Praise God.
I want my brother to know I truly enjoyed you. That was a word. There was no other way to cap off this school year. I mean, that word was from Holy Ghost headquarters. It didn't come nowhere from your flesh. You were the vessel of Holy Ghost headquarters. As he flowed through you tonight. Bishop, do you have anything else you'd like to say?
I could,
praise God.
Well, praise God. I want you to know it's been a delight for me tonight to come and share with you all. And I can tell that these are praying people because the prayer changes the atmosphere. So the liberty here that you don't find some places because you guys have been warned with the heavenlies. Y'all have done a tremendous job. I want to encourage all of you all. Your ministry, whatever God has called you to do, God is going to be faithful to you. He just wants you to be faithful to him. Do what you can. If you get stressed out, don't even worry about it, because God's going to take care of it. He always does. He's that kind of a God. I want you to know that y'all have one of the greatest ladies on this earth teaching y'all in ministry, Pastor Moore. I have tremendous respect for the chancellor of the school. She's a woman of God. I found her to be a woman of integrity, a woman of character. God does not commit to talent. He commits to character. She has tremendous character. I think that the sky is the limit for her ministry. She is going to go places. God is going to do great things. And we all want to be a part helping her to get where God wants her to go. So I'd ask everyone to continue to encourage her, continue to pray for her, because the enemy would love to stop this school, because you are equipping people in the body of Christ to come out and fight a good fight of faith against the kingdom of darkness. Darkness has already been defeated, but we have to enforce the victory. The Bible says the kingdom of God suffered violence, and the violent take it by force. That means he's not going to give it to us. We have to demand it. And I demand in the name of Jesus tonight that the enemy would take his hand off anything that you guys are doing. Anything that you are endeavoring to do for the kingdom of God. I prophetically tell you that God has moved and he has touched you and you have some liberty in your life that you didn't have before you came tonight, because God moves by his spirit. And never forget, it's by God's grace. Understand. want everybody to say with me, I am,
I am
what I am,
what I am
by the grace of God.
By the grace of God.
Say it one more time. I am,
I am
what I am,
what I am
by the grace of God.
By the grace of God.
Lift that right hand. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for he hath blessed us with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Amen. You dismiss, shake hands with your neighbor, tell them that you love them. God bless you. See you tomorrow night. You need some sustaining power because you're going to go through stuff that's going to rock your world. Stuff as a minister that's going to rock your world. You're not going to know if heaven's up or if heaven's down.